Welcome to episode 202 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent on a mission to show the public who the FBI is and what the FBI does through my books, my blog, and my podcast case reviews with former colleagues. In this special FBI recruiting episode, we get to speak to Supervisory Intelligence Analyst Sierra Stanczyk, who answers listener questions about the IA position, providing details on the qualifications, requirements, and duties of the intelligence analyst job. And then back again is Special Agent and Applicant Coordinator Cerena Coughlin, who provides an update on the FBI's current recruitment efforts. And towards the end of the episode, timestamps will be in the show notes. She talks about two other non-agent positions, the Investigative Surveillance Specialist and the Management and Program Analyst positions, and also the hundreds of jobs that will soon be open at the FBI's expanded facility in Huntsville, Alabama. Special Agent Cerena Coughlin also answers listener questions about educational requirements for non-agent positions, the availability of internships for high school and college students, the different ways the FBI might use expertise in the Middle East and Arabic studies, and the FBI culture regarding LGBTQ employees, particularly special agents. Detailed FBI employment information for all FBI positions is available at FBIJobs.com. Let me introduce you to Supervisory Intelligence Analyst Sierra Stanczyk. She was initially hired as a Management and Program Analyst for the Directorate of Intelligence and Cyber Division at FBI headquarters. In 2015, she went through the basic field training course at the FBI Academy to become an intelligence analyst, receiving at the time the Director's Leadership Award. Upon graduation from the academy, she returned to FBI HQ to work for the Counterintelligence Division, where Sierra also volunteered with the Victim Services Response Team, and in 2016 was deployed to the Pulse Nightclub Shooting Response. Sierra was transferred to the Philadelphia Division in 2017, where she was assigned to counterterrorism matters. She was named the FBI Philadelphia Employee of the Year for 2018 and was promoted to Supervisory Intelligence Analyst in 2019. Currently, Sierra leads a squad of intelligence analysts and staff operations specialists working on national security matters and serves as an instructor with the FBI's adjunct faculty program. For those of you who listen to the podcast for the true crime case reviews, we will be back next week with a fascinating look at a Detroit undercover case. But I thought I would slip in a recruiting interview as an extra episode this month. We certainly all could use the extra mental distraction. Before we get to the recruiting interview, I want to remind everybody that during the month of May, if you're a member of my reader team, you will be automatically entered into my 200th episode FBI and podcast swag and books mega giveaway. All you need to do is click on the May Reader Team email to read all about the FBI Silhouette Target Apron, FBI Challenge Coins, FBI Mouse Pad, and the podcast stickers and buttons, as well as print, digital, and audiobook copies of all of my books. If you're a member of my reader team, they could all be yours. If you haven't been getting my monthly emails in your inbox, remember to add Jerry Williams at jerrywilliams.com to your email address book so that the emails don't end up in your spam filter or promotion tab. I'll be announcing the winners of the mega giveaway in the June Reader Team email. Plus, based on the good response that I received, I will be hosting a live Zoom meetup on Saturday, April 30th at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'll be sending out an email this weekend and a few days before the event to share the Zoom access link. I am looking forward to virtually meeting you in person. I want to welcome new listeners and invite you to join my reader team. This podcast is all about true crime, but if you're also interested in crime fiction, once a month via my monthly email, I keep you up to date on the FBI and books, TV, and movies. When you join my reader team, you get access to my FBI reading resource, a colorful list of more than 50 books about the FBI written by FBI agents who have been guests on this podcast. There is nonfiction, crime fiction, true crime, and memoirs. And of course, this month, Reader Team members get to enter my 200th episode mega giveaway. You can join my Reader Team on my website or use the link in your podcast app's description of this episode. I want to thank you for your support. Now here's the show. I want to welcome my guest, Philadelphia Division Intelligence Analyst Sierra Stanczyk and Applicant Coordinator Cerena Coughlin. How are you guys?
Doing well, thank you. Well. How are you this morning?
I'm really distracted. There's a lot going on. I had explained that to you in this crazy world of ours, but I'm settling back down now and really excited to do this episode because I promised everyone to do this an episode focusing on the intelligence analyst position several months back, and I've been getting some impatient emails from people. So what I thought we would do first, before Sierra starts answering the barrage of questions that came in about the position, I thought, Cerena, maybe you could give us an update on how the pandemic is affecting recruiting when it comes to both the agent and non-agent positions. What's going on with the FBI?
Sure. So just to preface this by saying the information that I am providing right now is the correct information as of today, which means by the time someone is listening to this podcast, it could be completely different. Everything is so in flux, not just for the FBI, but the entire world. But as of right now, we are managing to keep up with our recruitment and our hiring through some pretty innovative means. One of the steps to becoming a special agent, for those of you who are familiar with the process, is the meet and greet. And we are actually conducting virtual meet and greets as I speak. We're doing them via Skype this week. We have in Philadelphia alone 46 applicants that we're conducting virtual meet and greets. I'm right now working on some different innovative ways to continue recruiting on college campuses. Thankfully, a lot of the universities in Philadelphia already have the means to do that, and they are already used to doing different virtual systems. So I just want to stress to everybody that the FBI is indeed 100% continuing to hire for the special agent position and all of the other roles that you see available on the FBI Jobs website. And we are here and ready for you to send us your questions. And I am on probably about a dozen phone calls a day from people that are interested in FBI careers. So it certainly is impacting how we are recruiting, but it is not slowing us down in any way.
And what about classes? Were classes canceled or postponed?
They were. So we sent home the people that were already at Quantico, and I just heard yesterday that they're looking to start it up again in the next month and a half or so. Again, that's the information I have as of today, and that could certainly change. But the Bureau, just like every other organization, we're trying to balance the concerns that we have about everybody's health with our need to continue the mission and to push that forward. So I know that they're not going to reopen things until they're as assured as they can be that it will be safe, but they are hoping to do that shortly.
And last question, Essential workers. Are FBI employees considered essential workers? Are you going into the office? Are you working from home?
We're doing both. We are blessed with the type of an organization that will allow us to do telework and actually is requesting that we telework as much as possible. We have a new SAC in our Philadelphia field office, and he has been amazing throughout this interesting set of circumstances. And he has really been stressing to people, don't come into the office just to come in if it's something that you can accomplish without going into a space that you're going to be right next to each other, go ahead and do whatever it is that you need to do, while at the same time being very mindful of the fact that we need to continue the mission. So a lot of us have been teleworking and going into the office on occasion.
I was wondering how that works out, especially when it comes to, you know, arrest and surveillances and all those things that need to occur, you know, on a daily basis. I take it in those circumstances, that's still happening.
Oh, absolutely. 100% mission is going forward. It's just the more paperwork side, which I'm sure you remember that, Jerry, a lot of those more administrative duties that every FBI employee has, those, if you would have to do them in the office, those might be taking a back seat. But in terms of the Bureau's work and what we do day to day, that is 100% going forward.
Very good to know. Any other updates before we let Cerena get on the hot seat? Do you have any other updates about recruiting for the agent position?
Well, I'm very proud to say that last year in Philadelphia, we had more than 35% of our applicants. They were female for the special agent position.
Yes.
And as of this week, the last time I checked, we are at 38% of our applications coming in are for females going into the role of special agent. And Jerry, you and I have had many conversations about that. I could not be more thrilled to see that. I think it's a wonderful position for a woman to have. It's a fantastic career, and I am so excited to be able to report that.
That is absolutely thrilling. I know that the percentage of females in the FBI has been around 20% for many, many years. So is that inching up a little bit?
I am certain that it is. I don't know the percentage of the current workforce, but with this number of applicants that we're getting, I know that those numbers are shifting up.
Excellent. Now, what I thought we would do is, again, focus on the intelligence analyst position. But after we have our discussion about that position, then I'd like for you to come back on and tell us what other non-agent positions the Bureau is looking for, you know, especially those positions where somebody who may have a college degree and who would love to join the FBI, but who doesn't want to be an agent. You know, they're not sure about making arrests and carrying weapons. What other positions are there available for them to look into? So we'll do that at the end of the episode, if that's okay.
Yeah, it sounds great.
Let me bring Sierra back on. You ready, Sierra?
Yeah.
I'm going to ask you the question that I usually save to the very end. Why did you join the FBI? Why did you want to become an FBI employee?
I think I share my story with a lot of others that I've met in the FBI over the years. When 9/11 happened, that was really impactful for me. And I had already known that I wanted to work for the government in some capacity. But after 9/11, I really wanted to go into national security. So that's where my focus was really in undergrad. I went to James Madison University in Virginia and studied international affairs and Arabic. And then upon approaching graduation, I applied to the FBI and was able to start shortly after graduation.
Why don't we take this in order? Why don't we start with the process of becoming an analyst, and then we'll move, you know, through the questions into what you do in the field. Does that sound good? And I have to admit this, that I'm going to be learning so much from you also, because I retired in 2008. And at the time, the intelligence analyst position was just really becoming a position. Again, right after 9/11, they did a lot of at modifications and enhancement to the position. Actually, Philadelphia at the time, a couple of years before I left the Bureau, started an intelligence squad. And I know a lot of us who had been in the Bureau for a while, you know, kind of looked over at the squad and it's like, you know, what is that? You know, what are they doing? Mm-hmm. What, you know, what's going on? Why don't we go ahead and just talk about what an intelligence analyst does from the point of view of being a new analyst at Quantico?
Sure. So new analysts go through the basic field training course at Quantico, which is what all new IAs and special agents go through once they get hired and they're onboarded. So it's a fully integrated training at Quantico. When I went through, we were there, the IAs were there for about 3 months, and the agents in our class continued on for another 2 months, so a total of 5 months down in Quantico. Overall, it was a really great experience, and it's a great opportunity to train with the agents and meet others going through the academy, such as staff operations specialists who go down for training for a month, as well as those going through the National Academy from state and local law enforcement, and in some cases, foreign law enforcement organizations. So day-to-day, it's a really great way to meet people and to start learning about the mission in an integrated format in anticipation of working with these different positions on the job every day when you get to your final placement. So BFTC itself, they're very long days of in-depth training and practical exercises. It's truly drinking from the fire hose and hearing about past cases and events which have shaped our organization over time. I joined, like I said, because of what happened on 9/11, and those lessons are very much still integrated in the training. And working with the agents and analysts side by side has been a priority for several years for the FBI, especially in Quantico. So it's been great having us all trained together in preparation for working more closely together in the field and at headquarters. There's also more specialized training at BFTC now in cyber, which is fantastic because cyber is hitting all of our cases in some capacity. At a minimum, we have to be more tech savvy and understand how our subjects are using technology to commit crimes. So I feel like that's reflecting very much in the onboarding training at Quantico. For IAs specifically, there is a lot of reading and writing and learning intelligence tradecraft and reporting standards. For instance, we learn how to evaluate information collected and ways to push that raw reporting out to the intelligence community as well as state and local partners. We also learn how to collate intelligence from a multitude of sources and develop assessments on that intelligence through which we really identify threat patterns or gaps, highlight operational opportunities, and forecast potential scenarios to inform our customers of emerging issues. And those customers can range to the agents themselves, executive management, external partners, foreign governments. We work with a lot of different organizations and a lot of different stakeholders. At Quantico, we also train on various tools and databases, and we walk through structured analytic techniques, which further refine how we applied tradecraft to the FBI mission.
While you're at Quantico, is that where you start specializing in a particular jurisdiction or investigative program? Do you come to the position, or do some analysts come to the position with those skills already?
So we go in learning about all of the different specializations and roles available, and about 5 weeks into the training, like the agents, we get our orders during orders night, and we find out where we're going. And over the course of the remainder of the training, we will be in touch with those offices to get a feel for what our potential assignments might be. And in many cases, it's very much to be determined up in the air once we arrive, because as you know, a lot can happen in just a couple of weeks or a couple of months. But it's very interesting. When I went through BFTC at Quantico, the other IAs were from all walks of life, had prior law enforcement or military experience, worked for different organizations that the FBI partners with each and every day. And they already had a lot of very interesting backgrounds for which they were hired in those specializations. And I was really impressed with how they were placed and what they ended up working on. It really seemed like the FBI honed in on what their prior experience was and matched an appropriate specialization and assignment for after Quantico.
Cerena, can we step back for a second and you give us some information about what qualifications the FBI is looking for when they hire an intelligence analyst? What's the difference between what they're looking for that position and, say, the special agent position?
Some of the qualities that we look for would be the same and similar. So I know you've heard me talk a million times about the core competencies related to the special agent position. Some of those same traits are ones that we look for in a good analyst candidate, things like communication skills, planning and organizing, initiative, leadership. So a lot of those will be similar, but what I always say about a really good analyst applicant is there's somebody who likes to do puzzles. There's someone who likes to look at lots of different pieces of information and look for patterns and try to put everything together as a cohesive whole. So a lot of the different qualities and traits will be similar. And I could say that about a good agent applicant as well. Often, some of the professional support positions are the ones that folks that want to come into the FBI but not have the law enforcement responsibilities of an agent, those sometimes are the positions that they flock to. So often what we're looking for is the same type of individual, but where their interest lies in terms of how they want to contribute to the FBI's mission might be different. We also look for people with academic backgrounds for the analyst position, and they don't always have to have the professional work experience component that you would need to have for the agent role. So you could come in as an entry-level IA directly out of college without a lot of the more practical experience, and you gain that experience while you're within the bureau versus the agent role that we're really looking for, that life experience, the variety of different situations that you have found yourself in other professional positions, because we need people to be able to think very fast on their feet as an agent because you're meeting so many different types of people in so many different types of scenarios versus the intelligence analysts. A lot of that experience can be gained from within.
Do you have people who apply for the analyst position who may have been former law enforcement or military people working in the intelligence field who may have aged out of the agent position?
That's a great question, because those are people that I love to recruit. Not only people who have aged out of the agent position, but might have physical restrictions that wouldn't allow them to fulfill the duties of an agent. So the various programs that we have through different veterans resources, like the Wounded Warriors program, those folks make fantastic IAs, and they are bringing that a wealth of life experience to the role, which is certainly a benefit for any position. It just, for an entry-level IA, isn't required. But we have quite a few former law enforcement and former military members that apply for the IA role specifically because they aren't eligible for the agent position due to physical limitations or because they've just aged out.
All right, I'm back to you, Sierra. So you've gone through the academy and you get your assignment. Is it like the agent position where you could possibly go to any one of our 56 FBI offices?
Yes, it is, with the addition of headquarters. So when we're going through and ranking all of our 56 offices, we have to rank a 57th being headquarters. And many of us end up going to an operational division at headquarters right out of Quantico.
Looking over your bio, you spent time at headquarters. Did you go to headquarters first before coming out to Philadelphia?
Yes, right out of Quantico, I went to counterintelligence division.
All right. And so how did you get to Philly?
I transferred a few years ago at this point, not really knowing what I would do in Philly. And it ended up that there was a vacancy for a domain counterterrorism position. So that's what I ended up doing when I transferred to Philadelphia. I worked counterterrorism for a couple of years. I'm very happy to be here. This is home for me. So I was actually shocked that I was able to get back. So it's been a really, really great experience in the office.
When I was there, they actually had an intelligence squad where all of the analysts worked. But are you now assigned to a particular squad? Are you sitting and working with the agents who are also investigating the violation that you're keeping tabs on?
Yes, so we are embedded with pretty much every squad in the division, as well as the resident agencies for Philadelphia. And there are also a couple of squads which are filled with primarily IAs that fulfill different roles at an enterprise level for the division.
Is there an analyst, or are there analysts for every single, you know, violation or squad that the FBI works?
We go through a lot of prioritization in terms of allocating resources and which projects to work on. But the great thing about being an intelligence analyst is a lot of the skills you learn, regardless of program or discipline, you can apply to a multitude of threats. So we see a lot of crossover across threat programs. And if you have a background in counterintelligence and then shift to a criminal squad to support those cases, we've seen a lot of success with that because a lot of the techniques and tradecraft are program agnostic. So as priorities shift across the FBI, I think one of the most rewarding things about being in an IA is the flexibility and the ability to work different threat programs and contribute to the mission in different ways and get exposure to different squads, whether they're criminal squads or national security squads.
Well, things are always changing. There's new threats that come up and, you know, new methods that come up. So what type of professional development do intelligence analysts undertake, and how often do you get to learn new things?
So intelligence analysts are required to complete at least 40 hours of training or professional development each year. So that is a major pillar for the role, in my opinion. And as a supervisor and FBI instructor, it's something that I believe strongly in and advocate for my team. So training and development come in all forms, ranging from micro courses, which we see a lot of now virtually and through webinars, all the way through conferences, in-person and hands-on training that can last days or weeks, or developmental opportunities in the form of TDYs to other offices, including overseas LEGATs, or perhaps detail assignments to other agencies. This emphasis on professional development strengthens Intel as a whole, in my opinion, because it adds a more diverse and skilled workforce. And like I said, we can plug and play on different threats and squads. So yeah, any training that I've taken throughout my career, I've been able to apply it to a multitude of violations. So that's been really, really great. I've also seen training re-energize intelligence analysts as they dive deep into new skills and mentor each other. So the IA career path can be very, very long. And so it's really nice to see, as the threats evolve or as tools and techniques evolve, seeing whether it be a new IA or someone who is more tenured pick up a new skill and really energize their career, and they head down a different path. So it's been especially rewarding to see this play out in the form of advancing cases and operations in new ways. The Intelligence Community Advanced Analyst Program, or ICAP, is an IC-wide program that certifies senior IAs who go through a series of advanced analysis courses. So these are courses that can be provided by other government agencies, including the FBI. This is really a commendable achievement and something some IAs strive for as a milestone in their analyst careers. Some IAs are laser focused on getting experience overseas or representing the FBI and other agencies to promote collaboration. And while others may want to serve as mentors, leaders, instructors, or even go into management, and there are many opportunities to develop in those paths as well.
Well, why don't we talk about the basic job duties, the embedded functions of an IA within a field unit? Could you talk about what that's like, the day-to-day?
Sure. So in the field, many IAs are generally embedded within an operational squad, which is assigned a threat to work. Some squads are assigned a specific violation, like healthcare fraud. while others work more broadly, such as international terrorism, depending on the office and the size of the program. So the IA's responsibility when they're embedded is really to provide analysis on the threat for that squad, for what they're assigned to work, and advance their cases while at the same time providing strategic direction to mitigate the threat. For instance, we'll highlight what we know about the threat and how it's impacting our domain or how our collection posture stands up against the threat. And the IA on that squad is balancing a lot of that workload and assisting the agents with analysis of their cases, usually alongside other personnel. So, Jerry, like you, what you were talking about earlier with subpoena returns or going through records, we have assistance with that, and a lot of the times when we're embedded, we're looking at a higher level to start connecting cases and connecting cases from other divisions or what other agencies are seeing and trying to really pull as many resources together for the special agent managing that case to make opportunities available for operations or to help them make decisions for how to advance the case in the future. And in addition to working side by side on these cases, embedded IAs may be tapped to assist with various operational activities such as conducting interviews, going out on surveillance, helping out with search warrants, and other activities that will often take them out of the office.
That's a big difference. Cerena, since you've been in the Bureau during the time period that the investigative specialist position, is that still there? Or was that enhanced to this intelligence analyst position? Because I know the intelligence specialists didn't go out of the office. They weren't at most of them, unless they were on ERT, you know, they weren't out of the office at searches and, you know, functions like that.
It has definitely changed. What we have now is, you know, the government alphabet soup. So, of course, all of the titles and the names have shifted around. I'm an investigative specialist now, actually refers to somebody that's on our surveillance team. So, completely different job role with the same title. So, we have, Sierra mentioned earlier, SOSs, and we also have OSTs. And a lot of the functions that the
I have previous, no idea what any of that is.
Yeah, it exactly. The whole alphabet soup. So the SOS position is the staff operations specialist position, and they perform a lot of the duties that the old IA position used to do, plus a lot more. And then we also have OST positions, which is fairly new. I want to say we've had that now for about 3 or 4 years. And that is, oh gosh, what does OST stand for? Operations Support Technician. And those individuals can fulfill a variety of different needs. Those can be the people that are helping out in our operations center, in the radio room. They can be the people that are the face of the field office because they're also manning our reception area. Or they could be embedded on a squad and assisting the agents and the analysts with things like subpoenas and helping to comb through and figure out where different resources can be directed. So the Bureau is continuously evolving, constantly trying to change the positions that we currently have as we see the needs come up. But the old position that you and I experienced, I want to say it was called an investigative analyst back in the day, that position doesn't really exist anymore.
Oh, that's really fascinating. So again, at the very end, you know, we'll circle back and talk about some of those positions that you just mentioned and the requirements and qualifications for them, because, you know, if somebody were to ask me, I would be of no help because all of that is new for me. So, but we're going to concentrate again, we're going to, you know, stick with the intelligence analyst position. And Sierra, you were just able to explain to us what it's like to work on a squad, embedded in a squad, but you had also mentioned that you were an IA at headquarters. So could you tell us the difference? Can you compare what it's like to work as an IA in the field to what it's like to have a headquarters position?
Sure. So my first position out of Quantico was at headquarters. I was assigned a very specific target set to work for the counterintelligence division, and I really loved it. I had the opportunity to spend every day learning about this very specific target set, seeing reflections in our cases at an enterprise level, and provide analysis to the intelligence community about where I thought this specific threat was heading and how it was impacting our national security. I was able to write an intelligence assessment and brief the product to cleared executives as part of a Department of Energy working group several years ago. And it was amazing to work with other IAs who spent their entire careers at headquarters and are regarded throughout the community as experts on particular issues. I wanted to spend my entire career there and one day be one of those experts. And then life took me to Philly and I got to experience being a field IA, which has been equally rewarding. Now I see cases more closely and experience, you know, advancements in those cases more directly. And I have the opportunity to work other threats and programs and apply knowledge that I gained over the years. So the work compared to headquarters is very much at the ground level, being a field IA. And being involved to get cases open, identifying specific ways to collect information and move these cases forward, and integrate that threat information into the larger picture, which inevitably feeds the headquarters perspective at an enterprise level. So having those strong relationships among IAs throughout the field and headquarters is really important for how the FBI identifies and mitigates threats and how we adapt and evolve as threats evolve. So yeah, a lot of the difference lies on what you're working. And like I said, at headquarters, I worked one very, very specific target set the entire time I was there. And when I came to Philly, I was working counterterrorism, counterintelligence, cyber, and working all different threat issues. So it's a very, very different experience, but very, very rewarding.
Well, I would imagine that if you're working out of headquarters, you're not getting out of the office very much.
You'd be surprised. I got out of the office a lot to go to other agencies for a lot of different meetings, and I was involved with one investigation that was handled out of headquarters that took me out of the office a little bit, and it was kind of like a hybrid field embedded IA role just out of headquarters. But I think there's a lot of opportunities for collaboration across the different agencies that are based in the DC area. So that's where I found myself really leaving a lot. I spent a lot of time at some of our FBI offsites, and I spent a lot of time with various three-letter agencies throughout the region.
All right, Cerena, that brought up a question that I had about the transfer program, because you know a lot of times when people are interested in the special agent position and they hear about the transfer policy that their, you know, first office could be anywhere, you know, small to medium size or, you know, or large office throughout the country. That's what makes them hesitant and are even decide that they don't want to apply for the FBI. But it sounds like the analyst position has some of those same concerns. Is there an opportunity for an analyst who is hired to say, hey, look, I only want to work out of headquarters?
No, not really. The chances of getting a headquarters slot versus a field office slot are pretty strong. I would say, and Sierra, correct me if I'm wrong, I would say that the majority of IAs spend at least some time at headquarters, often at the very beginning of their career. But you can't really say to the Bureau, I will only come and work for you if I'm guaranteed this one location, because we're just not built that way. We have to have employees that have the flexibility to be where they are needed. And that is for both of those positions, both the IA and the agent role. There is certainly flexibility in terms of movement once you get in. As Sierra said, Philadelphia for her is home, and she was able to make it home. That's actually why I'm in Philadelphia, not because this was my home location, but because it was my husband's. And I was able to, for my very first office, actually report back to my home area of Southern California. Right now, for new agent classes, about a third of those classes are getting their number one choice, and the other two-thirds are getting in their top five. So that has certainly changed since you and I came in, Jerry, when people were regularly getting offices in the 50s in terms of their choices. So there's a lot of opportunity for movement, but the Bureau would never be able to guarantee you will definitely get this one and only office.
Yeah, it didn't work that way when I came through. I was living in Virginia and my first office was Sacramento, California. You can't get much further away from, you know, the East Coast than that. So it's nice to know that it's changed.
In terms of the odds being in the current applicant's favor as opposed to the way that it was in the past, that has certainly changed. You are much more likely to be able to get at least the region that you're hoping to get now versus 20 years ago.
And as far as the IA position, that means that an analyst could have the opportunity, I like to say it that way, sounds so much nicer, to work in any of the 56 offices, but again, hopefully one of their top choices.
Yes, I mean, everybody is able to rank their choices specifically because we hope that we will be able to match the needs of the FBI with what the individual candidate is hoping to get.
That's really interesting. I wasn't aware of that. I would take it, though, for the analyst position, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the larger offices have an even more stronger need for IAs, you know, such as your New York's, which you haven't mentioned, Chicago, LA. Are those offices needing more intelligence analysts than others?
Well, I'm sure that every field office would love to get their hands on more intelligence analysts that they have, but it's all about the shifting around of resources. The offices that are larger tend to be the offices that are busier because more cases are generated in those offices, are assigned to those offices, come into those offices. They tend to be target-rich environments like New York, like Los Angeles, like the Washington field office in DC. And so the resources of all kind, monetary resources, budgetary resources, and personnel resources are naturally going to float toward those different locations. So you're going to see more analysts in those offices, just as you would see many other positions, such as special agent.
International travel. Sarah, are there IAs that are actually assigned to any of our overseas legats?
We definitely do. And I think there's even more of a need as time goes on for more IAs to be deployed overseas, whether it's for permanent assignments or for short-term TDYs.
I would love to start all over again and have an opportunity to work overseas as an FBI agent. It just sounds fascinating. So, you know, whether you're an agent or an IA, it would just be wonderful to be able to take advantage of those opportunities. All right. So you had mentioned something about paths, that there are different paths that an IA can work in. Could you tell us what those paths are and explain the opportunities?
Sure. So generally, there are three paths for intelligence analysts, and we talked about the tactical or embedded role at length earlier. The other paths are strategic and collections or reporting, and those are really higher level in terms of the perspective that you're looking at and the nature of the work. You might not be as involved with the day-to-day cases like you would be if you were embedded, but collections and reporting, you're looking at numerous cases across the division or across the program and working to identify gaps, make recommendations to fill those information gaps, and get that reporting out to the intelligence community or state and local partners. So that's, you know, one of the roles that you could potentially be placed in. And another role is strategic, and strategic's looking at, again, from a higher level perspective, connecting cases with each other from other divisions or even within the same division, and working with headquarters to really develop that strategic understanding about a threat program. So really, it's just how granular are you going to get into the cases and topic areas that we're working with on a day-to-day basis. And all of these roles are complementary to each other. So overall, like any job in the Bureau, you have an opportunity to make the IA role work for you regardless of which path you're placed in. If you're embedded with a squad, there will be regular opportunities to go out on interviews, assist with search warrants, go out on surveillance. And for those in a strategic or a reports role, you can make those opportunities by working with your embedded IA colleagues and assisting other squads with specific projects. And there are many collateral duties that can get you out of the office, such as the evidence response team and other groups. When I came to Philly, I was assigned to work counterterrorism at a strategic level. However, I was able to help out one of our resident agencies with a high priority CT case and ended up briefing the AOSA at one point to assist the team. I was also a member of the victim services response team, so I deployed to mass shooting responses such as the Pulse nightclub shooting in 2016.
I saw that in your bio. And what would be the type of assignments that an IA who would go to a mass shooting, what kind of assignments would you have there?
So my skills as an IA were immediately put to use because I was initially placed in the command post in the Orlando RA, and that was really critical to working with our counterterrorism division and other intel folks that were stationed throughout the area, as well as with other law enforcement agencies to deconflict and share information about what was happening. And then I moved to the Family Assistance Center, where I managed the intake process for victims and their family members. So while most of my time, you know, as an IA, I was working at my desk, working cases and tracking threats, whether at a strategic level or at headquarters, a very, very focused level for a specific threat set, I felt like I had a lot of great opportunities to get out of the office without being away so often that I couldn't close out projects or see my projects or products through to the finish line.
See, I'm learning so much. And I think one of the advantages, you've mentioned this, you know, about getting out of the office. And I think one of the advantages of being an agent, you know, when I was coming through, is our ability to make our own schedules and be in charge of our case and decide, you know, when we need it to do things. Does the IA have that same flexibility? Are you expected to be in the office, say, from 8 to 5, or can you make your hours when appropriate?
So your schedule really depends on the team you're assigned to and your role. If you're embedded on a squad, you may have a squad supervisor on the operational end who is flexible with hours, but just wants to ensure you have some overlap with the agents in the office in case there's anything you need to collaborate on. However, you may be in a role that requires you to have more regular or standard hours because of your responsibilities. It really just depends. From my own experience, I kept regular hours at headquarters and in the field, but my supervisors were always flexible if I needed to come in late or leave early. For instance, when I was in headquarters, I enrolled in a part-time master's program. Those days, I was able to get into the office super early and leave early in the afternoon so that I could head to school in the evenings. So I feel like it really depends, but overall, there is a lot of flexibility, and especially now with what's going on, there's even more flexibility.
All right. All of these questions, I forgot to mention this, but all of these questions were sent in by listeners who were interested in the IA position. And I thought this one was really important for us to answer. What she asked was, you know, there is a misconception out there that IAs are almost like glorified secretaries who just do the work that the agents don't want to do. How do you answer that question? And when you look at how IAs are portrayed on TV and in movies, I'm particularly talking about the new TV show on CBS, FBI. You know, how do you feel that the IA is portrayed?
So to answer your first question, from my view, intelligence analysts play a critical role in the FBI. And I think the more understanding about intelligence across the board, the more that that's come from increasing awareness of the role and the benefits of bringing intelligence into the fold of operations, I think the better. Intelligence is really for everyone. It's meant to advance your cases, identify threats, and really connect the dots in a very target-rich environment where the threats are constantly evolving and you're really seeing a lot of reflections in everyday life and a lot of priority issues that I think are becoming more public that maybe the public didn't previously see. So it's also important that we actively advocate for intelligence. It's not enough to sit on the sidelines and not offer our services or our perspective. So a lot of it is an educational and advocacy issue. We are very much a part of the fabric of the FBI, and the more that we proactively provide our assessments and assistance, the more we can drive operations and support the FBI mission. So, like any other position, you might have a customer that doesn't know what you can bring to the table, and it's our job really to help educate that so that the agents and other personnel working in the FBI know what we can do, what we can provide, and how we can all work together to benefit and move the mission forward. So at the end of the day, the FBI really benefits the most from a complementary relationship between operations and intelligence. And while the roles are different, neither can operate in a silo. And that is true for other positions in the FBI, like surveillance. Intel is a mission critical role that we play, especially in the sense of identifying new operational opportunities and emerging threats that may result in shifts in our collection or our caseloads. So Intel can often come off in movies or TV shows as bookish or nerdy or rigid or even out of touch, or the role is entirely conflated with an operator, like an analyst is behind the desk one day and then jumping out of a helicopter shooting at terrorists the next day. That does not happen. But I'm married to an FBI agent, so whenever we're watching TV or the movies and we see the FBI portrayed in Hollywood, we comment on just the different stereotypes of agents and analysts, and it's very, very interesting to see how those kind of play out in Hollywood.
Yeah, so of course that is one of my major missions, you know, with everything that I do, debunking those cliches and misconceptions, you know, about the FBI in books, TV, and movies. So I want to ask you about, this is my question. Have you ever watched the TV show FBI on CBS, the new one?
I have not yet seen it. Are there like stereotypes for analysts that you see, or what is their portrayal, if portray analysts at all?
Yeah, oh, they absolutely do. And I haven't watched this season. The first season, I watched every single episode and wrote blog posts about, you know, what they got right and what they got wrong. One of their central characters was Kristen, who was an analyst. And she was something else. You know, they really put her in a good role. She knew everything, though. You know, if they had a question, mm-hmm. she could find the answer in a second. That was a little far-fetched that she mm-hmm. was able, through facial recognition, be able to identify somebody immediately and tell you, you know, where they went to high school, or, you know, when they were in jail, who was their cellmate. That was a little mm-hmm. ridiculous. But no, she had a good position. You know, a very important role in the FBI office as portrayed in the TV show. But what happened at the end of the season is that she got, quote unquote, promoted to the agent position. How many intelligence analysts come into the FBI, and either you or Cerena or both can answer this, come into the FBI with the intentions or hope of one day becoming a special agent?
I think many do. I wouldn't be able to say the majority, but I think there's definitely a portion out there that come in as an IA or another role within the FBI, and their ultimate intention is to become an agent. But I've also found that a lot of IAs come into the role and end up really enjoying it. And after seeing kind of firsthand the reality of what the IAs do in all different positions, including the agents, a lot of them find that they made the right decision for themselves personally. So it really just depends, but I think with a lot of the work that we rely on to actually get the job done and support the American people is through the agents managing cases and running their cases to the ground. I think you're always going to have a lot of interest of people wanting to support the mission in that aspect. But yeah, I think it really depends on each individual person, why they joined and where their passion lies, and if They really enjoy the IA role. A lot of them stay. I've seen some agents transition to the IA role, but more often than not, I see it the other way around where IAs are transitioning to the agent role if they're leaving the position at all. So it's very interesting, but I think, you know, over time we might see different trends depending on, I guess, the general makeup of the FBI if we get an increase in intel personnel.
As a recruiter, if I have somebody that will express to me that they have an interest in getting a professional support role in order to become a special agent, that's usually not something that I encourage, because a lot of what we need for a special agent is experience outside of the FBI that they can bring to us that will enhance us as an organization and also assist them when they're going out and talking to such a wide variety of people. Because that's really what an agent does, is they go out and they talk. They talk to victims, to witnesses, to communities, to subjects, and they need to have this wealth of experience to draw from because they're talking to so many different types of people. And usually if somebody wants to take another role in the Bureau specifically to become an agent, I'll tell them, well, look, there are better ways to prepare you for becoming an agent. But then I also have a lot of people who ask me, well, should I be an analyst? Should I be an agent? And that I'll tell them, hey, the roles, there are certainly some cross-pollinations in terms of what you do, in terms of the type of people that make good agents and good analysts. But at the end of the day, you really need to decide what is drawing you. And I think even though a lot of people do transition from one role to the other, you kind of want to decide that early on. And the individuals that do choose to become agents after they've spent time in the Bureau, I hope that's more because once they view the agent role, they say, hey, that's something that really interests me and something that I would like to do, versus people thinking of other positions as a stepping stone, because that really isn't what it is. The professional support side of the house, it's not in support of the agent, it's in support of the overall investigative mission. And every single position has a part to play and is critical and important. And the IA position is 100% of equal importance to the agent position. We just do different things.
When I think about the main difference between the IA and the agent position, of course, I think about the arrest powers and carrying a weapon every day. What other differences, and of course, I'm going to ask you about money and salary, but are there other differences that really someone deciding which one is best for them should also think about? Am I missing anything else?
It really does come down to, do you just love to interact with all types of people? If you're someone that loves to interact with all types of people, you want to have a different day every single day, something that's very unpredictable, and you do have an interest in the law enforcement side of things, then the agent role might be the path that you would want to choose. The IAs, they certainly need to have good, strong communication skills, but they might not be interacting with the variety of folks that agents do. There is a difference in terms of not so much salary as the benefit of being able to retire at such a young age. On the agent side of things, you are eligible to retire at age 50 with only 20 years of service, and your mandatory retirement at 57. That is not the case for the IA position. Sierra, you might want to speak a little more on that.
I forgot about that one. That's a major difference.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Our career paths definitely have the potential to be a lot longer, and that, you know, affects opportunities for if we're going to stay within the same division our entire career path, if we're going to go into management, if we're going to do detail assignments to other agencies. There's definitely a lot more time to potentially work with to explore all of those opportunities. But yeah, it follows the standard retirement, I believe, as other government positions that are non-1811.
That's really interesting. All right, so one of the questions was a listener asking me what some of my experiences were working with IAs, and I've already said that I've had none, because the position started to morph just before I left the FBI, but at a time when I was out of investigations, when I was serving my role as the media representative and spokesperson. So I had minimal experience. So I'm going to throw that question to you, Cerena. What have your experiences been on the investigative side working with IAs?
Well, I worked counterterrorism for 8 years across two different field offices, and then I also spent about 6 months TD-wide for a CT case that I can't really go into details with, but that's probably where I spent the most time working with analysts. And it was absolutely 100% a partnership, side by side. They had the bird's eye view of information that was coming in from resources that were overseas, from other intelligence community members that I did not have, just focused on my singular case. And that was incredibly valuable to have. I spent some time working on a case that was more of a domestic terrorism case, and I was the only agent in the bureau that was working that particular group, and there were several analysts that were able to provide information that had been working on it for a number of years before I had actually taken on the more investigative side of the case, and the information that they provided me was amazing. We also had embedded analysts on the cyber squad that I worked on in Philadelphia, and the wealth of knowledge that they were bringing in really made a huge difference. So I could not sell the analyst position or recommend it more highly for individuals that are interested in supporting the FBI's mission. The type of person that really does so well in the analyst role is that individual that's able to see things in a multitude of ways, to see things from that more bird's eye approach, and then also to be able to get into the minutia of the data that we're going through. And those type of people can really, really make a difference in a way that no other position really can.
Yeah, I can see an analyst, and I'm sure this is the case, you know, anyway, becoming the go-to subject matter expert and many things, you know, within the FBI. So Sierra, I'd love to ask you about an IA who wants to obtain one of those high level leadership roles within the FBI. What kind of things did you take? Because you are a supervisor, so you're at that level. What kind of things did you do early in your career that kind of set you up for advancement?
So like any other position with the FBI, this role is really what you make of it. So I really worked hard to find things that I could do or build within the organization that would be of benefit to the mission and to other people. And everyone you meet in the FBI is now a part of your own network. And it's important to cultivate that network early on, because in many cases, you will see those people again as they move through their careers and as you move through your own. So I've been in the Bureau for almost 11 years, and I have contacts from the very first day that I started that I've leaned on as mentors or bouncing ideas off of, or if I've established something somewhere, seeing if they want to get involved and help out. And that's really made such a huge difference. Each person has their own career goals and trajectory, and being open to new opportunities and learning new skills will become especially important as those in your network are looking to hire for specific opportunities or grow their own teams. So people that I worked with years ago are now unit chiefs or section chiefs or even higher executives, and it's really great to keep that network in touch to hear what opportunities are going on in the field or opportunities at headquarters that I could leverage to get that exposure and experience that would help me in my own leadership role. I've heard more often than not that when a leader is looking for another leader, they're less concerned about the subject matter expertise of that person and more concerned about that person's work ethic as well as their abilities to lead and work on a team. So I've really taken that to heart over the years and really cultivated from my own viewpoint, wanting to have a reputation of being a really hard worker and innovative thinker. And I think for both of those, that's what I really strive with the team that I manage. Leadership development is a major priority for the FBI, and the lead where you stand concept is key to this program. And that's really what I've emphasized throughout my entire career, having that impact and influence without being in a formal leadership role. You can still make the world of a difference and lean on your network for mentoring opportunities and setting up initiatives that will cascade throughout the organization. All employees are encouraged to take leadership courses and to network and participate in mentoring programs to further refine their leadership skills to achieve that transformational leadership phase, which is all about inspiring positive change to support the FBI mission. I also think the FBI views leadership as position or field office agnostic. So again, it really comes back to what you make of your position, how you lead where you stand, and the network you cultivate to create leadership opportunities for yourself as well as for others.
Excellent. During your 11 years of being an intelligence analyst with the FBI, I'm sure you've seen and heard a lot of things. One of the questions that came in is that they wanted to ask an IA, what do you know now that you wish you knew before?
So I wish that I knew off right away would be to own the intelligence role, and that there's no one perfect way to be a great intelligence analyst. But if you own it and take pride in the work and work hard every day, you will learn so many new skills and build a phenomenal network and create opportunities for yourself to support the mission. I was in the FBI for several years before becoming an intelligence analyst, and I was very comfortable with my previous role. To essentially start over was both exciting and terrifying, but I've learned so much and I'm so glad I went through the process and joined the intel ranks. But my first year out of Quantico was very challenging. I was impatient with myself, and I just wanted to eat, sleep, and breathe this target set I was assigned so I could start becoming one of the experts that I worked alongside with every day and had so much respect and admiration for. It was really hard to be the new person in that first year. And it took me a while to really understand that a great IA comes in really any form. But every great IA I know has these qualities. They are intelligent and driven, but humble and approachable. So they can easily work on teams and work with others, but still bring that vast knowledge and background to the equation. They're also very creative and proactive, but they also roll up their sleeves and get the work done. So that's one of the things that I've really emphasized, is not just coming up with great ideas, but actually seeing them through and putting them into action and making them a reality. That I've worked with that are great leaders, and they really own the intelligence role, but they are also position agnostic when it comes to supporting the FBI mission. And that has especially come into play with the ongoing pandemic now. So at the end of the day, we're here to support the mission and work with each other and protect the American people and uphold the Constitution. And that's why we join the organization, and that's why we show up and work hard every day.
Well, I have to say, Sierra, I am so impressed with you. And I could not have, or Cerena could not have provided a better intelligence analyst with the FBI to talk to everyone about what the position is about. You are a fantastic representative of everything the FBI stands for. Good job.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been a great experience, and I'm really happy to share more about what we do.
All right, Cerena. I do have some really interesting questions that came in about the agent position, but before we move on, I do want to talk about what other positions in the FBI are for people who want to be involved in law enforcement, who like being involved in investigations, but for whatever reason, don't want to be or can't be a special agent. What are the great non-agent positions in the FBI for people to look at?
Sure. So, Jerry, you and I are always talking about the myths and misconceptions that people have about the Bureau. And probably the number one thing that I deal with is people thinking that everyone in the FBI is a special agent. I have folks contact me all the time and they say, well, I'm 43 years old, or I have bad knees and I really wish I could come and work for the FBI. And it's a shame that they don't realize that there are more than 800 different job roles and titles in the Bureau. So we have more than 35,000 employees in the FBI, and only about 13,000 of us are special agents. So we're actually a minority of the overall workforce. I wanted to highlight a couple of different jobs, and then I wanted to talk about something that isn't so much a position as it is a location. So the first one that I thought I could bring up is our surveillance specialist and investigative specialist position. So careers in surveillance. So people that go into this field are individuals that can represent every walk of life. We have surveillance specialists that look like college students. We have surveillance specialists that look like grandparents. We have individuals that drive around in minivans with the little stick figure family on the back window, and you would have no idea that they are a surveillance specialist for the FBI. So that is something that a lot of people wouldn't realize exist. Now, agents do conduct surveillance. It's certainly one of the major roles, one of the major responsibilities that we have. But we do have a team made up of professional support, so non-sworn individuals, they're not agents, that is what they do. They get to travel all over the world. They are involved in mobile surveillance, fixed surveillance, aerial surveillance, and they do counterterrorism cases, they do counterintelligence cases, they do criminal investigations. The training that they go through is quite intensive at Quantico. They leave there better drivers than Mario Andretti. The training that they go through is intense, it's amazing, and it's an excellent opportunity for somebody that doesn't necessarily want to go the agent route, but wants to get out there on the bricks and experience some of the excitement of following somebody on foot or by vehicle. And that particular position, we open that up regularly for hiring. And with all of these positions, I would recommend a visit to our website at FBIJobs.gov. And if you go into the job search portion on the website, you'll see a listing of all of the roles that the FBI currently has available. And one more thing I would like to mention about that, make sure that you're looking only at positions that are available to all US citizens or the pool positions. You're going to see a lot of jobs that are listed on there that say open to current FBI employees only. That would be a position that you would have to already be in the FBI to be eligible to apply. And I know I mentioned earlier, I don't necessarily recommend people getting another role and then hoping to transition that into a special agent job. But there are certainly a lot of entry-level positions in the FBI that then you can turn into an amazing career in another role. I know I mentioned the OST, the operational support technician position earlier. That is our primary entry-level, get your foot in the door, get a taste of the FBI job that can then lead you into other positions. One other job that I wanted to highlight is our Management and Program Analyst, the MAPA role. That is a fairly new position. It is the type of job that somebody that's interested in helping to direct the future of the FBI for them to consider. They are business analysts. They provide support for law enforcement, national security, and administrative functions all across the FBI. Our MAPAs analyze data, they make programmatic recommendations, and they advise managers on ways to improve performance. So the MAPAs have a major influence in the direction that the FBI will be headed in. And I know that we are currently hiring for different MAPA positions. And again, I would encourage people to go to the website for that. The last thing that I wanted to make sure I mention is our expansion of our facility in Huntsville, Alabama. So this is a place that we already have established, but we are undergoing a tremendous transformation there. Huntsville, Alabama was recently listed as one of the best places to live in the United States. I think it got the special award for the value location for having the lowest cost of living with the best perks in terms of quality of life. And we are going to be hiring hundreds of people for the Huntsville area once that facility has finished its expansion. And that will be everything from laboratory positions to individuals who would ordinarily be staffing roles at our headquarters, things like MAPA positions. So again, everything is available at FBIJobs.gov, and I encourage anybody who's interested in a career with the FBI to go there and spend a couple hours exploring.
All right. I'll make sure to put a link to the FBIJobs.gov website in the show notes for this particular episode.
Great.
All right. So I just have a few additional questions, one about non-agent positions. So my friend Frank, who is here in the Philadelphia area, a professor at one of the local colleges, wanted to make sure that you address the education that was required for non-agent careers. Because for the agent position, of course, you do have to have the four-year bachelor degree from an accredited university. At all of the positions that you've just mentioned, that you've just highlighted, do you have to have a college degree for those?
So each position is going to vary, and I get this question all the time. So there really isn't a one-size-fits-all answer, because each position has its own requirements, and many of the jobs will exist along a spectrum. Let's just take the IA position, for example, or the SSG position. You can come into that at a lower rung on the GS scale, so at a more entry level for that position where they don't expect you to have a lot of work experience yet because you're a recent graduate, or you could be an IA or a surveillance specialist at a higher level where you're expected to produce differently and bring more to the table, including higher education. So degrees can also substitute for experience, but you need to look at the requirements for each position listed on the job search feature of the FBI Jobs website. For the MAPA position, I know that we hire a lot of folks that have MBAs for that. I know that we hire a lot of recent JD graduates. So for some of the positions, we are looking for higher education. For other ones, a college degree isn't required. So there are a handful of positions that don't require a degree, but to be perfectly honest, those are disappearing. Those positions often are ones that would require a lot of work experience in that particular field and are often trade positions. So an example of that would be in our automotive unit. It's not like we can just drive our bureau cars into Jiffy Lube to get them serviced. We have our own automotive unit. So someone that would be eligible for that position, the college degree might not be as critical, but we would be looking for a number of years of experience in that area.
The answer is it depends on the position.
Very much so.
All right. Well, I wanted to also talk about internships. Frank also asked me about the availability of internships in the Philadelphia area and, of course, you know, throughout the country. And also, I had heard about a high school internship program, too. Is that something that is also available?
So we don't have a high school internship program. What we do have, though, is pretty fantastic. It's an FBI Teen Academy. We have that every year, usually in the month of August. I'm keeping my fingers crossed right now for this year. And what we do is have people from 13, 14 years old, all the way up to high school seniors that are eligible to come in for a full day that they hear a lot of the information that Sierra and I talked about today, about ways to go into FBI careers. They get briefings from our SWAT team. They get to try out different ERT equipment. They get briefings on some of the more exciting cases that have recently been adjudicated in Philadelphia. It is a phenomenal opportunity. And anybody that's listening that has an interest in that or would like to recommend a student for that, they can reach out directly to me. It's a program that's through our community outreach office, and it is an excellent opportunity.
And then the college internship program?
Yes. So the internship program is in a state of flux at the moment, like so many things are. Traditionally in Philadelphia, we receive about 250 applications and we'll get between 30 and 35 slots to fill in Philly. And when you apply, you list the field office you would most want to serve at, then our headquarters would ship those out accordingly. So we would get some in Philadelphia because that person listed Philadelphia as their top choice. The Washington field office would get a certain number and so on. So last year we had about 1,000 internship openings, and the year before that it was 1,200. And unfortunately, the current circumstances have caused this year's program to go into a bit of a tailspin. The individuals that were scheduled to report this summer, we were not able to have them come in because we have no idea really what circumstances are going to be like this summer, which is very unfortunate. But we, as of now, are opening up the application process for next summer, which would be the summer of 2021, sometime in the next few months. That opening usually occurs around August. But again, what I would recommend is a frequent visit to the FBI Jobs website, because that will always have the most up-to-date information. One thing I would really like to stress to individuals that have applied for our internship programs in the past and were not accepted into the program, that by no means is indicative of their ability to get a career with the FBI. The internship program, the way that it works, often individuals are selected in a way that it has nothing to do with their individual qualifications. It could be that that particular field office doesn't have a lot of slots. They may have received 350 applications and they're only allowed to have 3 interns. It could be that they need to have more of a variety in terms of the majors that those interns represent. It could be that they have a lot of applications from a particular university and they need to have more diversity in terms of the colleges that are represented. And it's a shame for somebody to think that they applied to the internship program and that means that the FBI would not want them for an employee after they graduate. And that is 100% not the case. And I would encourage anybody that was interested in an FBI internship and they did not get one of those very few slots to reach out to me, to reach out to their local recruiter, and to still look into the FBI as a career. That does not mean that they should dismiss the FBI.
Let's spread the word.
Yes.
All right. So then I have just 2 more questions that came in, and I thought we would just take the opportunity to answer them now. I do answer questions when appropriate that I get. I get lots of emails. Love to hear from people who listen to the podcast. But there are some times when I know I don't have the answer. And as you know, I reach out to you and ask if you could contact the persons and answer the questions. But these came in just before our recording of this episode. So, and I thought they were appropriate for us to answer for the larger group. And one of these was from Andrew. And Andrew is applying for the FBI position. He is currently working as a campus police officer at his college and taking up Middle Eastern studies and Arabic. And he wanted to know, besides counterterrorism investigations, are there other areas of investigative priorities concerning the Middle East? In other words, does counterterrorism predominate the FBI's concerns regarding the Middle East?
I will answer this question, but I would also love for Sierra to have any input in this, particularly because of her counterterrorism background. I can't obviously speak to current investigations in the Middle East or anywhere else, but I can say absolutely that there are cases that take us all over the world for a variety of reasons and different types of cases. Often this is because our cases are increasingly involving online resources, and there are areas in the world where money is sent, laundered, forwarded, etc. The same is true with the trade of illegal images, such as child pornography. We also have counterintelligence cases that take us all over the world. So the bottom line, there isn't anywhere that we don't have reach and that could involve any of the 300 plus different violation sets that we're responsible for. The world is a much smaller place. than it used to be, and our cases could take us anywhere. So I would say all of that applies to the Middle East and to anywhere else in the world. It's a shame that people would always associate the Middle East exclusively with counterterrorism cases, mostly because of the cases that we took on after 9/11. But there are victims, witnesses, subjects of our investigations that would take us all over the world. And Sierra, I don't know if you have anything you would like to add to that.
No, I agree with everything that you said. Having that expertise is fantastic. Being aware of the language, the culture, all of the issues going on across the world, including the Middle East, I think we see reflections in all sorts of cases, like Cerena mentioned. And it's really helpful to have that perspective and insight and even the willingness to tackle a language that difficult speaks volumes of your initiative and what you want to work and your desire. And we'll definitely put all of that to good use, regardless of what threat program you would be contributing to.
Cool. All right. The next question I got from Cole, and Cole is applying for the SA position, and he indicated that he was a gay male. And he asked me about the FBI's culture regarding LGBTQ plus employees. I knew a number of lesbian agents who were very open and very accepted in the FBI, but I didn't know any gay male agents.
I'm actually thrilled that this subject is being brought up. We were talking about disappointments related to COVID, and one of the biggest disappointments for me is that this summer I won't be able to participate in the Pride festivities that we had the pleasure of joining in last year. It was the Philly field office's first time walking in the parade, and we had a recruitment booth set up at the end of the route. And I stood there side by side with gay and lesbian FBI personnel who were fully out and proud to represent the FBI as gay men and lesbian women. The Bureau has diversity advisory committees for a number of groups, including for LGBTQ employees. And they make it their job to go out into the community and talk about what it's like being in the FBI as a gay, queer, or transgendered person. To be successful, the FBI must have a diverse organization because we are servicing a diverse populace, and we are only stronger when we have every type of individual in our ranks to help to educate, communicate, and inform us as an organization and the people that we interact with. So unlike 10, 20 years ago, even as recently as 10 years ago, the Bureau is very out about the LGBTQ employees in our ranks. And it's been supportive as an organization for a number of years. I would argue probably longer than a lot of government organizations. We do have this excellent kernel of leadership within that diversity advisory committee. That is exactly what they're doing. They're going out and talking to other people about what it's like to be gay, LGBTQ, and also be an FBI employee.
I have to ask you this question. You explained how the FBI is supportive of the LGBTQ plus community. How was the community receptive of the FBI being present at the Pride Festival?
Oh, I'm so glad that you asked me that as a follow-up question. It is one of the highlights of my career that day. I'm getting tingles just thinking about it because it was the most amazing experience. How many people we had walk by, glance at our table, then do a double take, then do a triple take, and come back over to us and say, "What's the FBI doing here?" And it was amazing to be able to tell them that we were there for a multitude of reasons. One is because I was there as a recruiter to ensure that we get the word out that we need to recruit a diverse group of people to come into the Bureau. Also, as a recruiter, it was an excellent opportunity for me to get out there and talk to a group of professionals because there are certainly many professionals represented in that community. But also, we had an analyst standing at the booth that was there to talk specifically about what the Bureau has in terms of civil rights violations and hate crimes. And we had the most amazing reaction from the people that were there. We had people that said, can I just give you a hug before I walk away? I'm so excited to have the FBI here and for you to be here for the reasons that you're here. It was an amazing day. And I would say that the response that we got was overwhelmingly positive. I actually can't think of a single negative interaction that I had.
That's good to hear. All right. So I think we're done. I like to have my guests kind of wrap up what we've been able to talk about during the episode. So I'd like to have Cerena go last. So because she is our special guest, you've been here before. So Cerena, why don't you wrap it up and give us what your last word would be, and then we'll go to Cerena.
Well, I don't want to be a broken record, but I mentioned this at the beginning. It completely depends on when it is that you're listening to this podcast. This could be something that you're downloading 6 months after we recorded it. But I would really like to stress that during these trying times, during the last few months where so many people have found themselves unemployed, are now in a position that they are reconsidering the type of career that they will move into next, I would really want to stress to them that the FBI could be the perfect organization for them, that we are 100% hiring right now, that I am very busy as a recruiter, and that I would love for them to reach out to either me or to their local recruiter to talk about the careers that we have available and something specific for them based on the work experience that they already have.
Cerena?
Thank you again for having me. The intelligence role is very, very rewarding, especially in an organization like the FBI. And to really highlight what Cerena just said, if you're looking for a challenge and you really love to work with others and have opportunities to travel and learn different skills and figure out different and creative ways to be a leader and to support the FBI mission in protecting the American people, the intelligence role might be the perfect role for you, and I highly encourage you to pursue it.
And that's the end of the interview. At jerrywilliams.com, you'll find a photo of Cerena Stanczyk, links to articles on the FBI's website about the intelligence analyst position, a link to FBI.gov, and lots of photos, courtesy of the FBI, of agents and intelligence analysts working and training together. I hope you enjoyed the interview and that you'll share it with your friends, family, and associates. If they're not sure how to listen to a podcast, have them read the post on my website, How to Listen to a Podcast, and subscribe to FBI Retired Case File Review on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, your favorite podcast app, and also YouTube. I'd love it if you also check out the link to my books in your podcast app's description of this episode. My nonfiction, FBI Myths and Misconceptions, A Manual for Armchair Detectives, which goes through 20 cliches and misconceptions about the FBI in books, TV, and movies. And there's also my word search puzzle book and my Philadelphia FBI Corruption Squad crime novel series. All of my books are available wherever books are sold as ebooks, paperbacks, and audiobooks. Please consider leaving a review. Reviews help readers find good books. Thank you for listening to the very end. I hope you come back again for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.